to start one of my many stories in the yellow part of my life, which in my own interpretation, yellow means your childhood, amongst many other things, in the sweat ceremony. So I want to start with when I was a little boy. I've always lived in or around Prince George. Very, very large family. Very poor. Lots of struggles. Lots of things that I had to face. But there were some good moments too. There were some good moments and very nice memories that still linger in my mind. We lived by the Fraser River, down in this flat area, and there was an old meat packing plant, just a big empty field. We lived in a rickety old log house, and we lived a few years down there. But we had to walk through the cemetery every day to get to school, through the old graveyard. And it was really, really difficult because there was a lot of things going on at home, a lot of drinking, a lot of just dysfunctional stuff. But there was this beautiful little woman and her husband who lived just up for months. And for some reason, she was always in our lives. We called her Little Margaret and Little Joe because they were such tiny people. But she had a way about her that was really impactful. And I think she cared about us so much and tried to protect us from things going on at home and everything. So she would always invite us up to her house. So we go up there and watch TV. If there's anybody in here who's my age, I'm around 67 now. But there used to be a show on CBC way back in the 50s called William Tell. It was in black and white, and William Tell would, the show would open with William Tell and his crossbow and he'd spin around and shoot this apple off this guy's head and split it in half. Well, I was hooked on William Tell. He was my hero then. But we'd go there when that show was on. We'd go there and watch him. She put a blanket on the floor and give us little goodies and everything. And then she made this big announcement. I guess she anticipated there was going to be a big party at our place, so she wanted to get us out of there for the weekend. That's all I think. She said, boys have to come over on the weekend and spend the night because we're going to watch colored TV. I was like, whoa. In 1959, those years, boy, that was like holy big stuff. Anyhow, I couldn't wait. We talked about it all week long at school. Come the weekend, we went over there. She had everything ready, blanket on the floor, bunch of goodies for us, and anyhow, she turned the TV on, and I'm looking, I'm thinking, oh, it's the same TV, what the heck. Anyhow, she comes out of the room with this big cardboard box about that tall and about that long, maybe that wide, and lifts the top up and reaches in and whips out this big piece of green plastic. Clips it on the front. It's actually beautiful now that I think about it because we watched TV, green TV for a week. Then she would say, come over the next weekend and we'd watch it in red, blue. It was good times actually. But were challenging times too, because I had a lot of fear in me, afraid of a lot of things. And I remember my first encounter with a true wild animal. It was a wolf. It was a Saturday, we were all at home, and I thought I would challenge myself to go for a walk along the river by myself. And I did. I walked down there, and as I'm walking along, it's just a wall of willow on this. This is wintertime. And I'm looking at the house, and pretty soon I can't see the house. I'm a long way from home. And anyhow, I get to this wall of willows, and something catches my eye, and I stop, and I look, and I can see the outline of this animal. And I look closer, and it was a wolf. And the wolf, when a wolf is, maybe there's some troubles, but every time I've experienced an encounter with a wolf, for some reason they put their head down, lower to the ground, and they kind of look up at you. Oh my God, I freaked. I thought this is the end of it. My biggest challenge, my fear, and when I came face to face with that day. But I'm looking at this wolf and thinking, I think I'm dead. As I stood there frozen, I realized the wolf knew I was there. He really didn't care about me. He must have killed something, maybe a rabbit or something. Anyhow, he stood there and looked at me for a few moments. It seemed like eternity to me, and then he went back to what he was eating. And I kind of started backing up, taking slow steps, and got out of there. But boy, that stayed with me. It stayed with me all my life, actually. But it was my first encounter with an animal. And what did that animal actually mean? It was a beautiful, powerful experience for me.
Did you see the senseless slaughter? Did your conscience bother you? Did you think the things we told you were stories that weren't true? If you want to know the answers, then let our spirit be your guide. You know you are your brother's keeper. You hold the keys to what's inside. I am
way.
I am way.
I am way.
I am way. I am way.
I am way.
My dad died when I was 9. And things got pretty chaotic. But had to go to school, had to struggle through all that. Hard times, I guess you could say. School was a real challenge. Going to school and especially lunchtime. All the kids open up their lunch bucket and they're saying stuff like, Bobby, you want a treat for a cake? And here's my knee sitting in the classroom with a little brown paper bag that was supposed to last a whole month. My mom would really get upset that there was holes in it. So every time the lunch bell rang, my brothers and sister would run. We'd run to the bush room and eat our lunch, which was usually a piece of batting with bear grease on it. Soft. So I started to get angry and not want to be in school at all. I started to drink. I was 12 years old, I think, when I started to drink. And I do recall, I remember it was a bottle of lemon gin that I had stole from the previous night's party. So. God, did I ever get sick on that one. Well, my brothers and sister and I drank really, really drunk. That was about the time we left the flat down below the cemetery, and we moved out to a little village east from Stuart. I was 14 years old, and I had enough of school at that point. So my younger brother and I just decided we were going to just go and live on the streets. So we left downtown Prince George. This is my first encounter with insulation. But we were cold one night and thought, wow, this would be really fluffy stuff to sleep in. Oh my God. Never do that. It was so bad. Anyhow, we survived the streets for quite some time in the winter. And that one night it was minus 25 or something, and I said to my brother, we're not going to make it through the night. We used to go down to the old burner at the mill, at Lakeland Mills, and warm up there and sleep in that roundhouse where they bring the engines for the trains and then they turn them around. And we'd hide in there. It was warm in there. The snow and grease all the time. Anyhow, we knew we were going to have problems if we didn't go to my mom's house. 20 miles away by railroad. And we went down to the train station. Passenger train left it every night at 10 o'clock or something. And we hung on, we climbed up, we snuck to the other side and climbed up between the coaches. And we grabbed on these little ladders up on the main. I grabbed onto one this way, and he was behind me with his back, and we put our backs together and just held our breath. And lo and behold, when we get to Willow River, 20 miles away, the train wasn't stopping. Nobody was getting on or getting off. But what they do is they slow down and they blow the whistle. He says, "Oh, Phil, we have to jump." And yeah, I know he was scared. I was scared too, but I managed to jump. I dove off that train and hit the snow on the side and never hurt myself. And then I hollered, "Jump, jump!" And I saw him in the darkness. I saw him jump from the train. And I kind of ran over there and make sure he was okay and he was fine. And we made our way to my mom's place and walked in the door. I really don't remember what happened after that, but I do remember the ambulance siren going and seeing the red light hitting the trees and everything. Apparently I went into a coma for days. And when I woke up, I was underneath this big, big light in the hallway of the hospital, and there was this lady leaning over me, and she had a name tag on it. I remember her name tag said, "Miss White, Nurse White." And she was sponging me down, break my fever, I guess, but she was so happy when I opened my eyes. And, "Oh my God, Marcel," and she hugged me. I don't know what ever became of that lady, but yeah, I survived that. I survived that. The doctors said then I would never be able to participate in sports and to play music that required anything that required the use of my lungs. They were so badly damaged. Wow. I've been playing the guitar and singing my lungs out here. I think the doctor was a little bit off. Yeah. It was also the time that I started watching the ravens and what the ravens do. Their way of living was quite like mine. You ever watch the ravens? Crows fly south in the winter, the ravens stay around, but you see them and you go, "Wonder where he's going." I sometimes think that the raven doesn't even know where he's going, but he's going somewhere. And he always winds up probably with a meal and a place to stay. But that's kind of how I felt at the time, that I was like the raven, eh? Just out there, flying aimlessly around. But little did I know that I actually had a purpose. All right. Tiana saw that in this, and Charlie had another play. Okay, see, Master, who's been changing me? The wind, the change I know have set me free. And faster I run to finish line. The boyhood things I wanted but left behind. Like a lion waiting, hiding on his prey. I only fear the needs of just that day. But then a red and winding path before me lay. My pride restored, you sent me on my way. Facing me, I like what I see in change. It confuses me to hear the things they say. We seek you and we worship in our own way. You know the wizards came, we had nowhere to hide. They stole our kids, then locked them inside. And our beliefs, our tongues, our clans almost destroyed. Preaching, gloating, and truly overjoyed. But now I'm facing me, and I love what I see. In change. about my adult life, my transformation years that really, really became more than obvious and clear to me who I was, what I'm supposed to be. And I'm living in a little town just a short distance from here in Cornell, actually. And they lured me into becoming a board member. And I had an auto body shop and I was doing okay. So I signed up as a board member, and lo and behold, before I knew it, they railroaded me into being president. Which was a good thing. They decided to host a mini powwow. Anyhow, they brought in these drummers and dancers, and I went there, suit, tie, welcomed the mayor and all his dignitaries. It was pretty cool. But it was my first time ever at a powwow. I'd never been to a powwow in my life. I heard sometimes drumming and that, but I'd never been to one. So they have a big drum like that in the middle of the gym, and all these singers gather around and they're drumming, and they're, oh my God, and the energy and the sound and everything kind of started to go into me, inside me, and I couldn't fight it off. I couldn't fight it off. But something in there clicked. It clicked. And I started to cry. I had no idea why I was crying, I just started to cry. And I started to cry uncontrollably. And I remember people passing tissues and other things to me to help me out in their own way, I guess. And here I am, crying. All these dancers had come in, and they were beautiful. Man, they were beautiful. Especially the lead guy. He had this big long staff with an eagle claw on the end, and his feathers hanging down from it, and he was swaying all over. And he's dancing towards all of us. And he had the biggest smile with the biggest teeth I ever seen in my life. But he was beautiful. Two long beards or braids that were turning gray. He was stunning to look at. He dances right by me, and all the other dancers are following. Drums pounding away. I couldn't help it. I just started to cry. And I couldn't even lift my head up. I had my head down. Embarrassed almost that I was crying the way I was. Anyhow. Out of that line of dancers came this beautiful older lady in Alkali Lake, I remember. And she had a great big beautiful feather with her. And she came over to me, standing with my head down, crying. Says this to me. She says, "I don't know who you are, my boy, but the drum's calling you home." She said to me, "I don't know who you are, my boy, but the drum's calling you home." Something so hungry to know who I was. To know who I was, that drum woke it up. inside our head, inside our heart. Even the word tells how you were born. Yeah, the night before the fight. When the camp lay very still. You saw red and you saw white. But the blood imposed its will. You came to conquer and divide. We know you're cold and you're ruthless. We you're the crazy maker. You're the crazy maker.
We are the crazy makers.
But even though my seeing him was a good part of that, still hadn't come home. Still didn't understand where home was. And then I had a beautiful, heartbreaking incident. But it was, it had to be that way. I get a call, 12 o'clock at night, Saturday night. And this old lady says, Marcel, can you bring your drum and come and help us release the spirit? And I go, really? She said, yes. They were arguing with an hour. I said, okay. I took my drum and I drove down to this apartment block, Prince George. And the door is wide open, and here's all these people standing around, and they lead me in through the door with my drum, and they bring me upstairs. And there on the bed is this beautiful older lady and her daughter, and there's a blanket covering the body on the as a young woman, 30-some years old, who had passed away. And they wanted me to come there and sing Amazing Grace to release the spirit. Well, I can't touch it or feel it. It's hard for me, but I did it. The bedroom window was wide open. And there was people standing around. And they did the first verse of Amazing Grace, which is a beautiful song. And I didn't want to look at the two on the bed. I kept staring at the window, just trying to keep my composure. When I got to the second verse, oh my gosh, everything just, those two women started to wail. When you hear my people when they're in pain, especially the old one, they're shocked, eh? And my mom used to do this, she'd grab her mouth and she would say, Tatisra, which means, what happened? Oh my God, kind of thing. I got to the second verse, that's what that lady did. And I believe that at that moment, that song had brought them to that place of acceptance that their daughter was gone. And then, because they accepted it, that to me was the releasing of the spirit. People have to do the interpretation, but to me, that's what it meant. And I thought, oh my God, now I understand what this is about. Anyhow, I left. I did my part and I left. I found out the next morning they wanted me to stay because apparently that girl was 350 or 400 pounds. Well, it was quite a chore to get her out of there. Because of what I had done, they brought me to the Blackburn Hall when they had their potlatch, they won't say it. They sat me down. First time ever, I'm Carrier. On my mom's side, I'm Ojibwe and Swampy Cree and part French. On my dad's side, I'm Hollow Water, Manitoba. sat me in the wrong place first. They had to pay me double because they made that mistake. I didn't mind that. By the time I left there, I had a mountain of appliances and food. Like, what am I going to do with 20 bags of flour? Like, oh, baby. I wound up giving pretty well all of it away, but it was a beautiful experience. I guess what I'm saying is that the most powerful and the most beautiful part of it all was that they sat me down and told me where I belong. They sat me with a beaver club. Beaver club. It was the completion of my journey.
Distractions can lead us astray, but sing the same stories in a new kind of way. Hey. Yeah, there's cries from the city and into the towns, political promise trying to smother the sounds, the once even wealthy and up opening their doors. Afraid that soon they'll join rank with the poor, yeah. Just don't sweat today. Just don't sweat, okay. Just don't sweat. No sweat, okay? know the salmon are dying, they got nowhere to lay. The trees are infected with the chemical spray. But I still believe that we can find a new way. If we live for tomorrow and not just today.